Welcome to the channel Learn with Danish. Subscribe and hit the bell icon.
Hello all, welcome to the channel Learn with Danish. Today's video is a special video because the voiceover would be done by Archa Farooq, Assistant Professor of English at JDT Islam College of Arts and Science, Willimar in Calicut. The topic that she would be taking is Ozymandias, written by P.B. Shelley. I welcome Archa Farooq to take over the class.
Have a nice and peaceful day, everyone. Today, in this video, we are going to discuss the poem Ozymandias. Ozymandias is a poem written by P.B. Shelley. P.B. Shelley or Percy Bysshe Shelley. We generally mention this poet as P.B. Shelley or just Shelley. Shelley was a very famous literary figure who lived during the Romantic period. He actually belonged to the the group of poets like Romantic poets or Romantic writers. P.B. Shelley belonged to the second generation of Romantic writers. The Romantic writers were actually divided into first generation writers and second generation Romantic writers. The first generation Romantic writers includes like the poets like William Wordsworth, S.T. Coleridge, Sade, Walter Scott. And the second generation poets or the second generation of Romantic poets or writer were the poets like Shelley, Keats, Byron. So P.B. Shelley belonged to the second generation of Romantic writers. He was one of the major Romantic poets who is regarded as an influential and philosophical one. Shelley is a popular literary figure who is he's also famous for lots of odes like Ode to West Wind, Ode to Skylark, etc. Shelley has also been an influential persona who advocated protest through non-violence, and he also had inspired many great personalities like Leo Tolstoy, who indirectly influenced our Mahatma Gandhi, and again Mahatma Gandhi, who also became the inspiration of another great personality like Martin Luther King Jr. and so on. So this poet basically is a great person. Another fact which could be added on to his credit is that he was also the husband of Mary Shelley, the famous author of the famous work Frankenstein. So Ozymandias is one of the many poems written by Percy Bysshe Shelley. So this is an important poem written by P.B. Shelley, Ozymandias. Let's move on to the next slide. Before getting into the poem directly, we'll have a look at other details of the poem. Basically, who was Ozymandias? Ozymandias was the Greek name of Rameses II of Egypt. It was the Greek name for the Egyptian pharaoh Rameses II. Shelley actually began to write this poem after the British Museum announced their acquisition of large fragments of the statue of Rameses II, which belonged to the 13th century BC. Now, what is the poem all about? The poem mainly discusses the themes like the uncertainty of life, the impermanence of life, through the character Pharaoh or through the character Ozymandias. Here the poem talks about a greedy and arrogant emperor who lived long back, who was very arrogant about his existence, about his richness, about his wealth, his power. And here the poet is indirectly conveying the idea that nothing is permanent. One day or the other, everything will perish. We human beings are generally an arrogant creature who boast of their deeds and very proud of their achievements. But ultimately, we have to realize the fact that ultimately everybody have an end, everybody have a decline. Ultimately, we'll just turn out to be a heap of dust. So poet is trying to put light on this reality that nothing is permanent. So moving on to the form and structure of the poem. This poem is written in the form of a sonnet. A sonnet. I hope you all know a sonnet is a poem written in 14 lines. And this poem, Ozymandias, is written in iambic pentameter. And the rhyme scheme of this poem is ABAB, ACDC, EDEF, EF. This is the rhyme scheme of this poem, Ozymandias. And it also has a lot of figure of speeches like metaphor, irony, enjambment, synecdoche, alliteration. So this poem is a very rich poem in every sense. It is a beautiful poem with a great message to be imparted. A very meaningful one, which put forward an everlasting theme, an evergreen theme. Nothing is permanent in this world. In the slide, you can find the poem Ozymandias, written by P.B. Shelley. The first line of the poem is like, I met a traveler from an antique land. So the poem starts like this, where you can find a speaker. So the poem is written as an anecdote to the poet, okay, where a speaker narrates his experience when he traveled through an antique land. So the poet, the poem has a speaker there who describes a meeting with a traveler. There the traveler says that he has traveled lots of many places, and he also traveled to the place where the relics of the statue lies, okay, where the relics of the statue was found. Then the traveler narrates what he saw there, the fragmented pieces of statue in the middle of the desert. The face of the statue could be seen, and everything to the speaker. The traveler also says that only few parts of the statue were found. Okay, every other thing around the statue was destroyed. There was a pedestal on which something was written. A piece of the face of the statue could also be seen, on which the sculptor has shown his skill. A stern face was engraved on the stone, and the traveler praises the skill of the sculptor. And as I said, there was a pedestal about which the traveler was explaining, on which he said something was written. What was written on that pedestal? It was written like, look around and see how mighty I am. This was the line engraved on that pedestal. These lines very well conveys or depicts the arrogance and the pride that the emperor had. During those times, during the Ozymandias ruled his country, he might have been a very awesome, a very great person. At least he believed himself to be very great. But the traveler says that no evidence of other awesomeness, of his greatness, could be seen in the vicinity. Everything, every other things around, or every other richness around him, was destroyed, completely devastated. The traveler could only see sand, heap of sand and desert all around the relics of the statue. So now we'll move on to the poem. We'll analyze the poem line by line. The poem is like, I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert, near them on the sand. half sunk a shattered visage lies, whose fronds and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read which yet survive stamped on these lifeless things. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal these words appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains round the decay of that colossal wreck. Boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. So this is the 14-line sonnet written by P.B. Shelley, Ozymandias. So you can find the poem is written in the structure of first 8 lines and then 7 lines, okay, in octet and sestet form. I met a traveler from an antique land. Antique land means old place, an old civilization, like that, antique, old, ancient. I met a traveler from an antique land, an old place, who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert, near them on the sand. So the speaker is saying that he met a traveler who was traveling through an ancient land, who was traveling through an antique land, and there he saw two vast means big, and trunkless means bodiless. There wasn't body. I've told you, it was the whole statue was scattered, was broken into pieces, and many parts were missing. And what could be seen was only few sunken part of the face and few other parts. Okay, so the body couldn't be seen, and two vast and trunkless legs of stone. Okay, legs could be seen. Legs could be seen. Sand in the desert. Near them on the sand. So on the sand, two huge legs could be seen standing. Okay, only two legs could be seen. There wasn't any body on that leg. Every other parts were shattered. Okay, here you can find a figure of speech enjambment in these two lines. So enjambment is a figure of speech where you could find in lines when a complete idea is split into two lines, or when an idea is continued to the next line. So here, two vast and trunkless legs of stone. Okay, the idea is continued to the next line, and of stone, you can see. So there an enjambment is done. Again in the next line, you can see the long line is again split up. Okay, stand in the desert, near them on the sand. Sand is again written in the next part of the line. Okay, again there also you can mark enjambment as the figure of speech. Moving on. Half sunk a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command. Okay, half sunk a shattered visage lies. Half sunk. Sunk means poondakidaka. Okay, inside the sand. Sunk in the sand. Half sunk a shattered visage. Visage means face. Shattered means broken. So apart from this huge, vast two legs, what was the other part of that statue could be seen was the face, broken face, okay, was lying there, half sunk in the sand. Whose frown means an anger look, an expression of displeasure, okay, whose frown means oru puccha bhavam, okay, an anger look, a displeasure expression, okay, a displeasing expression was very well engraved on that stone. Okay, the face expression, the facial expression was very well carved on the stone. And that face was half sunk in the sand. And the wrinkled lip. Okay, wrinkled lip. Okay, the wrinkled lip. Lips had wrinkles. because he was a pretty aged person, even though not that old, but he must be in his 50s. And sneer of cold command. And sneer means a fake smile. Okay, and on his lips he had a fake smile of cold command. Cold command. What do you mean by cold command here is a very emotionless, okay, very cruel sort of person who didn't have any compassion towards his people, who was very arrogant. He already had a frown expression on his face and his wrinkled lips had a fake smile, and which very much depicts his cold command, his unaffectionate attitude towards his people. So in these two lines also you can mark imagery as the figure of speech, underline the words shattered visage, there comes an imagery as figure of speech, and then wrinkled lip, there also you can write the figure of speech imagery. Okay, then next figure of speech is alliteration in the words like cold command. Kerr is repeating. Okay, the sounds are repeating in these words. Cold command. So you can write, you can round those kerr there and write alliteration. Half sunk a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things. So in these lines also you can mark enjambment, because the lines are continuing. Those passions read, which yet survive, is also a continuous idea. Lifeless things, there also you can mark enjambment. And in next line also you can mark enjambment. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed, there also you can mark enjambment. So tell that, so this is a continuation of the other line, and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read. So now poet is praising the skillfulness of this person, this sculptor, okay, who engraved the exact expression the emperor had on his face. Sculptor means shilpi, okay, shilpi. So nalla bhangiyayittu nalla vyaktamayittu valare krutyamayittu എംപറിൻ്റെ മുഖത്തുണ്ടായിരുന്ന ഭാവങ്ങൾ അതുപോലെ കൊത്തിവെച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഓക്കെ, സോ വെൽ ദോസ് പാഷൻസ് റീഡ്, ആ ഒരു എക്സ്പ്രഷൻ, ആ ഒരു പാഷൻ അതുപോലെ തന്നെ എന്ത് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്, ഹി ഹാസ് എൻഗ്രേവ്ഡ് ഓൺ ദ സ്റ്റോൺ, വിച്ച് യെറ്റ് സർവൈവ്, അതിപ്പോഴും നിലനിൽക്കുന്നുണ്ട്, ഇപ്പോഴും സർവൈവ് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. Stamped on these lifeless things, on the stone. Okay, stamped means fixed. Okay, fixed or sculptured. Okay, so here in these lines the poet is praising the skillfulness of the sculptor. So he had read the expression on the face of emperor very clearly, and he had also sculpted the face very exactly. So the arrogance of this person, of this emperor, could be read even now. Okay, it survives even now. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. Again, heart that fed, there you can mark a right enjambment as the figure of speech. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. So here the hand is actually that mocked means actually what the poet is trying to convey is that even though actually the sculptor in another way he was mocking at the emperor, but despite of this frown expression which is sculpted on the stone, emperor must be very happy about that, because that was his exact facial expression he always had. Okay, so the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. So the hand that mocked, you can underline there and mark the figure of speech synecdoche. So synecdoche, synecdoche, is actually a figure of speech. in which a part is made to represent the whole. Here, a hand is used instead of, the word hand is used instead of the sculpture as such. Actually, the sculptor is mocking at the emperor by engraving the exact expression of emperor. Okay, but emperor was emperor was very happy to see the exact representation of himself. Okay, so hand that mocked, here the hand stands for sculptor, so a part is used to represent the whole, to represent the sculptor. Okay, so the figure of speech used there is synecdoche. And in the second part also, the heart that fed. Okay, the heart also is actually there also, synecdoche is used, which represents or which stands for the mind of emperor. So these are the figure of speech and ideas expressed in the first 8 lines or the octet. Now we'll move on to the sestet or the second part of the poem sonnet. And on the pedestal these words appear: my name is Ozymandias, king of kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. So now I've also mentioned almost all, every other part were destroyed. Okay, the time has destroyed, the time will destroy anything, right? So the parts which were left over were the huge two legs and a small part of almost half sunk visage or face of this huge sculpture and this pedestal. Okay, and this pedestal on which it was engraved, on which it was written, my name is Ozymandias, king of kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. You might have seen the movie Bahubali, right? So in that movie also you can find the king was making a huge statue of his out of gold. So there also, by the end, in that movie also, the whole face of that golden statue was broken off. That movie also, the idea put forward is the same: however powerful you are, there will be an end for you. So here also, in the pedestal on which this statue was standing, okay, in this poem, the pedestal on which this this statue made of stone was standing, these lines were written: my name is Ozymandias, king of kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. So now at this point of time, at this point of time where the whole thing is destroyed and devastated, these words are very ironical in nature. So these two lines are very important as far as this poem is concerned. So you can mark irony there. What is being directly mentioned here through these words are actually the king or the emperor were boasting about his deeds and his mightiness. Okay, the king is indirectly, or the king during those times, the king was saying that, you just see how great I am, how awesome I am, how mighty I am, and you just despair for your littleness, for your nothingness. Okay, so at this point of time, after many years after the destruction of this statue, the words written on the pedestal is intact. Okay, the words written, which is very much ironical in nature. Also, irony is another figure of speech where used to represent an opposite meaning of words. Okay, opposite idea. What is being said, the connotation is entirely the opposite of that. Okay. So that is very much true in this case, right? The you could find nothing of awesomeness, nothing awesome about Ozymandias at the present moment. So in that case, this sentence is very much ironical in nature. Moving on, nothing beside remains round the decay of that colossal wreck. Okay, the wreck means destroyed thing. Okay, shattered pieces. Colossal means huge statue. Boundless and bare. Again, you can note down alliteration there. Boundless and bare. Ber sound. Boundless and bare. The lone and level sand stretch far away. Again, you can mark lone and level. Again, alliteration there. Sands stretch. Again, sir sound. Again, sir sound is alliterated there. Nothing beside remains round the decay of that colossal wreck. Okay, nothing is remaining there apart from these two huge legs and almost sunken face or visage which had a frown expression on that, and this pedestal. During those times when the statue was built, during those times they might have been the city might have been a great city, and he was in the epitome of power during those times. But ultimately, through the time, through the years, it has proven that nothing is permanent. Okay, your arrogance, you shouldn't be so arrogant, okay, in your life. One day or the other, everything will end. We will turn out to be a heap of dust. Nothing beside remains round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare. The lone and level sand stretched far away. So there wasn't anything much left. Nothing awesome was left over there. So ultimately, we human beings have to realize the fact that through this poem, the poet is trying to convey that we will die one day. Everything will end one day. So there isn't any point in us being so arrogant, being us so very proud of our deed. We need to be humble in nature. So this is a beautiful poem written by Shelley, which deals with the idea of the inevitable decline of rulers, also we human beings as well, okay, who pretends to be very great. Okay, one day or the other there will be an end for everything. So that is the main idea put forward by poet through this poem. The poet was conveying through this poem. Okay, I end the video. I hope all of you have understood the poem very well. Thank you.